Welcome, everyone. Really glad to see such a beautiful It's really wonderful.
Lori.
Beautiful day. Everybody came in from their gardens.
Lori.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I'm really pleased and I'm so proud to introduce Roberta Bernstein to everybody. She's going to talk with us today, of course, about our famous neighbor, Jasper Johns, who is actually one of the most important American artists of our time. Roberta probably knows more about Jasper Johns than he does. Well, at least about him, of course.
Yes.
She wrote her dissertation about him, and over the years she's written many essays about him, and now she's working on his catalog resume of his paintings and his sculptures. She got her PhD from Columbia University, and she's taught art history for many years at SUNY Albany before becoming a professor emeritus. Throughout her career, she's written many essays about Johns as well as other artists, Ellsworth Kelly, Robert Rauschenberg, Andy Warhol, and Marisol Escobar. After the talk, there'll be time for questions here. And then we'll go, you're all welcome to go back to the library across the street afterwards. There'll be more time for questions and reception. And the library's collection of about a dozen books and catalogs about Jasper Johns will be on display here for you to look at. So welcome, Roberta. I'm very thrilled that you're here.
Thank you. Well, I'm so glad to be here, and it's wonderful to see how many people are turning out. And I've come to Sharon many times to visit with Jasper in his studio to discuss his work, and it's a pleasure to have this opportunity to meet some other people who live here and see the town hall and the library and get a little better feel for the town.
So,
thank you.
So, Roberta, where and when did you first see Jasper Johns' work?
Okay, I'll start with that. If the lights could just go down for the slides, all but the last. Thank you. I wanted to start with this. Yeah, all you could keep the last row on so it isn't so dark. Everyone can see, right?
Yeah.
Clearly. Okay, good. I wanted to start with this photograph, which was taken around the time I met Jasper Johns in the 1960s, in the mid-1960s. And because it's my favorite photograph of him. And I think it's because of the intensity of his gaze and also the joy in the act of seeing that it conveys. And so it's always been a favorite, and I think tells you a lot about what I find so fascinating and wonderful about Jasper Johns' art. I actually learned about his art when I was an undergraduate at UMass. John Cage came to UMass to give a concert, and I went, and I was totally baffled, but intrigued by what this concert was. It was basically him playing a typewriter, and the sounds being a lot for me. So, and this was 1964, so we're talking about early on. So I went up afterwards to ask him some questions, and he said, well, if you're interested in my work, you should go to New York to see the show of Jasper Johns' painting at the Jewish Museum, because you'll really understand what I do better. So I got myself to New York and saw this exhibition, which was Johns' first major retrospective. And I was bowled over by the visual impact and the brilliance of the work. And so that kind of hooked me. And then I moved to New York a couple of years later to start graduate school. and I went to galleries constantly. And one day I walked into the Leo Castelli Gallery, and there was Jasper Johns at the top of the stairs. He was my favorite artist, and I was going to get to meet him. And he very kindly invited me to visit him. He lived on Riverside Drive at the time. And we became friends, and I worked for him part-time while I was a graduate student, and then ended up doing my dissertation, as Laurie has mentioned, on Johns. And it was the first time anyone had done a dissertation on a contemporary artist at Columbia. That was a big radical thing at the time. But my advisor allowed me to do it on Jasper Johns.
And Roberta, could I ask you a question? Mm-hmm. What was the subject of the dissertation?
Well, actually, it was a study of his work from 1954 to 1974. And I then turned that into a book after I got my PhD and while I was teaching, and then wrote the other essays and articles you referred to. But about 10 years ago, when I was starting to update the book, I was invited by the Wildenstein Research Institute to be the author of the catalog resume of Jasper Johns's painting and sculpture. And up to this point, the Wildenstein Institute was based in Paris and had worked on French artists like Monet and Pizarro. And this was the first time they were going to sponsor a catalog resume on a living artist who was working in America. So it's been a really big deal. And it's been an amazing experience because, first of all, I've had a chance to come to Sharon and talk with Jasper quite a bit. But also, I've had a chance to look at all of his works very, very intensively and up close and personally. Can you just go back? Here, I'm working with a conservator in Seattle on the left and working with an art handler in Queens on the right. I would always joke how I had to stay in good shape to do this because, you know, I had to climb ladders, as in the case of the numbers painting that's in the lobby of the New York State Theater, and crouch down. You really have to stay agile to do this kind of work. It isn't all intellectual.
So should we move on to Jasper Johns' background?
Yes. And I just wanted to show one more thing, because I did get to travel widely, including as far as China. So here I am in Beijing doing the examination. As far as Jasper's background, Jasper Johns was born in 1930, and he grew up in Allendale, South Carolina, and often it's confusing because his birthplace is given as Augusta, Georgia, but that's because the closest hospital was right across the border in Augusta, Georgia. He actually lived and grew up in Allendale, and his parents divorced when he was two, and he lived during his early childhood, mostly with his grandfather, and then later with his aunt. And on the left, you see a photograph of his grandfather's house, where he lived until he was 9 years old. And on the right, a photograph of John's in the 40s as a teenager. He then attended the University of South Carolina for a few semesters, and his art teachers, recognizing his talent, encouraged him to move to New York, which he did. And then after about a year and a half, he was drafted into the service during the Korean War and stationed in Fort Jackson. And you see him here with some of his fellow soldiers. And Johns actually ran an art gallery while he was at Fort Jackson. And then for the last 6 months, he was stationed in Japan. But right after he came back and was discharged from the service, he moved to New York. And pretty soon after he moved, He met a lot of artists, including the three who he says were the most influential at that time. And in the upper left, you see composer John Cage, the right, Merce Cunningham, and below, painter Robert Rauschenberg. And all of these artists were very much involved in what they were doing and were real innovators and making their mark and breaking away from the traditional modes of art that were in the air at the time, and particularly pushing the boundaries between art and life, which became a big issue for artists, including John's, during the 50s.
Roberta, can I ask you a question at this point? Why did Jasper Johns become an artist?
Well, actually, I was going to mention, I think that's, you know, why do people become artists. He has said that he knew he wanted to be an artist from age 5. And he didn't really know what it meant. He had one relative whom he never met. This was his paternal grandmother who died before he was born. And he knew about her because she was a painter, kind of a Sunday painter, but her paintings hung on his grandfather's walls and in the homes of other relatives. So he knew he had a relative who was an artist, but he didn't really know what it meant to be an artist because he lived in this very small town with no real access to art. But he knew he wanted to get away, to be someone different, and being an artist became tied up with that idea. And plus, I think he just was very talented. And you know, one time I talked to one of his sisters who said, you know, when he'd come to visit us, he was always making things. You know, he would find pipe cleaners and make things and then sew things. And it, you know, and so I think he just was talented and liked to make creative things, and this developed into a career in the arts. Now, I wanted to say that, you know, what was going on in New York when he came to live in the city was primarily abstract expressionism. This was the dominant mode of avant-garde art. And here you see on the left, this is a photo, very famous photograph that many of you probably know, of a group that came to be called the Irascibles, and it includes Jackson Pollock, de Kooning, Barnett Newman, Rothko, among many others. These were the big names. Abstract expressionism was in vogue. On the right, you see a Pollock, Jackson Pollock painting from the 1950s. Now, Johns, while he admired the abstract expressionists, wanted to do something that was his own thing and that was more true to his own identity. And what he came up with that really opened the door to what came after was a painting of the American flag. And this is a photograph from 1955. You can see that flag. This is the famous first flag that now hangs in the Museum of Modern Art. And it's still in progress. You can see that it hasn't quite finished this field of stars. What does the flag mean?
He just been in the army. Was it a patriotic statement? What kind of statement was it?
Well, John's, interestingly, all he said about how he came to do it was that he dreamt one night of painting a large American flag, then woke up the next day, went out and bought the materials and started doing it.
So he never said more than that.
Not about its meaning. The only thing he said is that it was not a patriotic statement, nor was it an anti-patriotic statement. Now remember, this is the height of the Cold War, and the McCarthy hearings had just occurred. So there's no question that issues about patriotism and were very much in the air. But for Johns, it was about something else. It was about seeing something that was familiar in a new way. Now that doesn't mean that there aren't layers of meaning that are tied to what was going on in the times. I mean, I don't think he would deny that, but he never thought of it as being a patriotic symbol, or that motivated him to do the painting.
It's just such a loaded symbol that it's quite something to take that on.
Right, but I think that's why it's so amazing, because on the one hand, it's a totally common thing that we all know from childhood. You know, everyone knows. It cuts across every class boundary. And it's something like this one, right in front of us, typically. And yeah, it is so loaded with meaning. You know, people attach so much to it. And I think that's why it's lasted as such an important image in the history of art. You know, it isn't just arbitrary. Now, it did clearly stand out from what was being done by the abstract expressionists. By contrast, Johns's flags and targets look very cool, very detached, very, you know, not seething with emotion like the works of the abstract expressionists. And when he had his first exhibition at the Leo Castelli Gallery in 1958, his work started to be known to a wider public and made a big splash. Here you see him at the time of his first exhibition on the left with his target with four faces. And the painting drew so much attention that it was actually reproduced on the cover of Art News, which was unheard of for an artist who had never had a show before.
And he was only, what, 28 years old, you
said? Yes. He was 28 years old. So he was young, had been working in relative isolation, except for Rauschenberg and Rauschenberg, Cage and Cunningham and some other artist friends. But all of a sudden, he got this wide exposure, and on top of that, the Museum of Modern Art bought the painting out of the Castelli show, and it now hangs in the Museum of Modern Art. And here we see, in a photograph from the 60s, this is Leo Castelli, who was his first art dealer and remained so for over 35 years until his death. And, you know, really supported Johns's work, made sure it was widely known nationally and internationally. And Johns remained, you know, so many artists can be very fickle about their dealers, but Johns and Castelli maintained a very close connected relationship.
For how long, more or less?
Well, over 35 years. Like, I know the relationship started in 57, and then I don't know what year Leo passed away, I think in the late 90s. So until then, he was Johns's
dealer. And could you just say one thing about the use of familiar images as a way of exploring the act of seeing?
Okay. I wanted to just end the segment. Okay. No, sorry, I couldn't not show this image because, you know, I was going to say the rest is history. You know, after that first Castelli show, you know, MoMA buys his work, it's on the cover of Art News. Of course, nothing's ever that easy, but in fact, he is one of the most renowned figures and accomplished figures in the arts in our society. And he received the highest honor for a civilian in this country from President Barack Obama, the National Medal of Freedom, in 2011. And that was quite an honor, and you can see John's looking very pleased, as does the president, to bestow the medal. Okay, as to the question about familiar images, I mean, Johns is first and foremost committed to examining the process of perception, but not just how we see, but how we think about what we see. So by choosing familiar things, he's presenting something that we all know, that we've looked at hundreds, if not thousands of times, but by presenting it as a painting, we are confronted with something different from what we've seen before. And we have to look with fresh eyes. And that's really what he primarily wants you to do. So, and he also wants to create a situation where you don't quite know what you're looking at, because you see it and it's a flag, but then it's a painting because it's made of paint and it's a canvas on a stretcher. So is it a flag? Is it a painting? Is it neither? Is it both? And so you're thrown into this state where you have to see something that you thought you knew so well in a completely different way. And I think that's the key. And his early images were all flat, or mostly flat images and signs that were all very familiar. After the flag, he did targets. And the target focuses attention on the idea of sight, because when you use a target, you take aim, you focus, you look at the bullseye, you try to, you know, get your arrow to hit the bullseye. The first two targets, he, maybe because they were so symmetrical, he put body casts, fragments of anatomy, in boxes above the target, which creates a kind of disturbing image. But to a large extent, John's, I mean, people don't usually think of him as a figurative artist, but he really has always been concerned with the human figure. And I think what he did as first targets, he may have, anyway, had in mind this very famous image by Leonardo da Vinci of the Vitruvian Man. He was a great admirer of Leonardo from a very early age. And the way Leonardo uses the perfect geometric forms, the circle and the square, which is what John's does with his target, and shows the ideal human type from the period that he worked in, the Renaissance, you know, perfectly proportioned, wholly formed individual. Whereas John's working in the 20th century, mid-20th century specifically, has a very different idea about, you know, the image of the figure, and shows the figure as fragmented and in a disruptive situation.
Do you want to talk about the encaustic painting technique at this point, or is that?
Would you rather see that later?
Yeah, well, you can see the early works are all done in a wax-based medium that is known as encaustic. And you can see the kind of rich surface he was able to achieve in that way. And I have a couple of details later, a little bit later. Let me just check the time, I don't want to go too long. But I just wanted to, at this point, the familiar objects, the flag, the target, then numbers. Now, numbers are also familiar things deeply ingrained in human consciousness. You know, we all learn to count very early. So it's something we know very well early on. And John's also picked this subject because he was interested in the figure ground question. Everything he does has layers of meaning, including making you think about the nature of a work of art. So the figure five, it's a figure on a ground. Every artist who puts a brush to canvas has to think about figure on ground. You know, yet it also has a lot of other associations, including to the human figure. And John said he called his number paintings figures because, like de Kooning, he wanted to have his own group of figure paintings. So de Kooning did his women, and John's did his numbers. And you know, when you think about it, the numbers are very sensual, so it works. He then did his final flat motif, is the map of the United States. And this one dates, it's in the Museum of Modern Art as well, it dates from 1961. And just like the numbers were figures, the maps are his landscapes. And he shows the whole landscape of America in the form of this diagrammatic representation of the country. You can see that, you know, in a typical map, you know, every state would be a single color and everything would be clear so you can distinguish them. John's breaks down the boundaries so that the whole surface, it becomes an all-over surface of various colors, but he treats it very differently. And then among his other familiar objects were his sculptures, and probably the most famous of which is this sculpture of ale cans. He calls it painted bronze, because even though it looks exactly like, when you first see it anyway, real beer cans or ale cans, in fact, the cans are cast in bronze and the labels are hand-painted. Certainly when you see it at this scale, you can see that it's not a printed label, but it's hand-painted. And this sculpture was inspired by a remark that de Kooning made. He said something to the effect, and John's heard about this, that, oh, that Leo Castelli, he could sell anything, even a couple of old beer cans. Jasper thought, what a great idea. Because he loved to drink beer, and he used beer cans in a studio to mix paint. So he thought, this is a perfect idea. And again, you know, the fact that de Kooning said it, who he admired but wanted to distinguish himself from, was another thing that made it just the right thing. Okay, and then, you know, you can see when you look at the beer cans, the ale can sculpture, you know, how influential he was on a certain direction of art that followed. That's the so-called pop art movement of the 60s. Certainly Andy Warhol, with whom we see John's here, they both show the Castelli Gallery, was very much influenced by John's painted bronze sculpture when he did his first Campbell soup can paintings. But John's himself does not consider himself a pop artist. And in fact, he doesn't use brand names except in only a couple of works, like his painted bronzes, where it has to do with things that he used in the studio. But he was tremendously influential. Okay, and here are the details Laurie asked about encaustic, because very few artists were using encaustic. It was an ancient medium that had been somewhat revived in the middle of the 20th century, but very few artists used it. And when John's first started painting his flat, he started with enamel house paints, because he probably couldn't afford artist paints yet. And a lot of artists were painting with house paints at that time. And he got frustrated because the paint wouldn't dry fast enough the way he wanted to work. And he had read about this technique of encaustic in a book. He worked in a bookstore when he first came back to New York. And he thought he'd try it out. And he really liked the way the wax dried instantly so that he could layer the brush strokes. And he was interested in creating not only the physical layers of paint that he could get, but the way that implied the layers of meaning that he was looking for in his work. And he combined the layering of the brush strokes of paint. You can see how, when you look closely, you can see one laid on top of the other. But he also incorporated collage. He wanted to bring in materials from daily life. So he used pieces of newsprint that had ads and articles of all different kinds, and pages from books, and, you know, all types of things that added to the rich texture of the surface, as well as to the layers of meaning. And for the stars, in most cases, he would actually cut the star out of a piece of collage and place it onto the surface, so that it had a real physical property. So, you know, the flat flag design becomes something with dimension, a real thing, instead of something that is just an illusion of surface. And I wanted to show this detail from the star field. Every once in a while, you can see, read United States. This is from a seal that reads United States of America. Every once in a while, there's a bit of collage that relates to the theme of what he's painting. So, you know, that every, I mean, what I've learned about Jasper Jones from my many years of studying his work is that you never can take anything for granted. You can never think you understand it all or you've seen everything. Every time I look at a work, I notice something different. You know, like a little detail like this or some other detail or, you know, it's amazing how rich the work is because it can look so simple. Well, it's a flag. So what next? But when you really start getting into it, thinking about it, looking closely at it, it's an amazing experience. Okay, next. Yeah.
Well, we were going to talk about his use of repetition of images.
Right, okay. Right, because one of the things about John's that many people know is that he uses images again and again, but every time he does something different. I wanted to just read a quote. This is his second major flag that he did after the one I just was talking about. It's white flag from 1955. And he said, this I think helps you understand what he's doing. He said, I often repeat an image in another physical form just to see what happens, what the difference is, and to see what it is that connects them and what separates them. So it's about what if I do this, what connects it to what I did, what separates it. He's interested in those connections and separations. In this case, he enlarged the image to about 10 feet across. By the way, this one's in the Metropolitan Museum. Some of you might have seen it there. So he enlarged it and he eliminates the color. So it's basically drained of the red and blue and the white remains. But without that defining color, is it still a flag? Now we look at it and I think most of us see a flag because what else could it be? But it's a painting, and it's all white, and the flag keeps disappearing and reappearing as you look at it.
It seems to be more painting than flag.
Right, he's tipping the balance, and that's what he's experimenting with. How much can I push it to the painting and have it still remain flag? And then he could go the other way, too. This work, it represents a direction where he took the flag and instead of making the flag congruent with the edges of the canvas, as in the ones we just saw, he places the flag on a field of color. So then the question is it still a painting or is it a picture of a flag? And he's making you think about that issue. You know, he's also, by adding this luscious color, kind of almost pushing it toward decoration and pattern rather than reading it as an object with a certain kind of meaning. What's the next one? Johns would do things in different formats in painting. And he also would do them in drawings and slightly later prints. This is actually an ink on plastic drawing done 20 years after the painting. So he's using the idea of the flag on the field, but rendering it in a completely different medium with no color and with these the ink forming these fluid pools, so that again, the flag kind of becomes part of the surface in a very different way from what happens in the painting.
So the repetitions can go on for a long time.
Yes.
Yeah.
And here's the one that's on your poster, which is one of his most famous images. This is the three flags from 1958, where he's dealing with the issue of space. You know, a flag is a flat thing, but by repeating it three times in diminishing scale, he suggests the idea of perspectival illusion. But he actually reverses that, because the smallest flag is in front of the larger one. So he makes you think about that whole idea of space. And also, you know, here's a flag that's this size, then it's this size, then it's this size, but it's still a flag. And, I wanted to show the side view, because you can see that he not only layers the flag, but they're on separate canvases, so that he's stressing the fact that the painting is a literal object. It's not just a surface. It's not an illusion. It's a thing, a concrete, real thing. And I just wanted to show this comparison with Cézanne, because Johns is a great admirer of Cézanne, and again, from very early on. And just the way Cézanne repeated different groupings of apples in still life after still life, Johns repeats the flag in different situations. And, you know, one of his most famous statements is practically a cliche, if you know his work, is, you know, take an object, do something to it, do something else to it, ad infinitum. And you can imagine maybe Cézanne said that to himself. And somehow Jasper intuited it through the ages and came up with his own statement, because I really think there is an analogy between Cézanne's apples and Jasper Johns's flags in that way.
And that takes us into discussion of references more deeply.
Right. One of the things about Johns's work is the references he makes to other artists in his work. And this is a large and complicated topic, but I just wanted to show you a couple of examples. You know, he makes reference to Cézanne, to Marcel Duchamp, to Matthias Grunewald, and to Picasso, increasingly starting in the 1980s. And I wanted to just show a couple of examples from his series called The Seasons, where he specifically references Picasso's Minotaur Moving His House, this painting, where he adapts the imagery from the Picasso to his own artistic vocabulary, and thereby identifies with what's going on in the Picasso. So here we see the Minotaur, who is Picasso, moving a cart with his belongings, and that includes a big canvas, a ladder, tied together with a rope. Then there's also a horse giving birth. Picasso's lover had just given birth to their daughter. So this is how he represents his life in transition. He was moving, he just had a new child, his life was kind of in an upheaval. So Johns adapts this to his imagery. Instead of the Minotaur, this is Johns' shadow that's been cast and traced. So he's present there as a shadow. This is his canvas with some of his familiar images, including the flag and the Mona Lisa, to reference his admiration for Leonardo da Vinci. And then here's the ladder, the rope, the stars. Notice the stars in the green sky. So he's really looking closely. And he even shows, notice this little seahorse. This was painted in his home and French West Indies, so the seahorse. But the seahorse is a reference to the horse giving birth in Picasso's painting. So he really looked closely and played with these details to create an image that related to his own experience. Another Picasso painting he was looking at was this one called The Shadow. Okay, and here we have Picasso's shadow being cast through a doorway as he looks into his bedroom and sees his lover, Francois Gillot, who had just left him. So it's kind of a sad scene of being left by a loved one. But Jasper identified visually and probably also with the content, the moving content of the Picasso painting. And then Johns did a whole series of four related paintings that dealt with the four seasons of the year and also the stages of human life. And these are full of autobiographical associations and references to artists he admired, but they're also intended to make a more universal statement. So it's not really about him. It's about through himself and his experience, he speaks to the human condition. So here we have the figure split in half. This is fall, right? The ladder breaks. The rope no longer holds everything firm. Things slip away. The arm descends. There's a reference here to Marcel Duchamp. This is his profile. And the other details from Picasso.
I think we wanted to finish the talk by talking about John's life here in Sharon and how he likes living here and what he's doing here and how he works
here. And I do want to finish up, so I forgot that I had a couple of other things, but I'll go quickly through them. Because I wanted to say that John's does increasingly include references to his life, as well as to Picasso. This is a Picasso mural called Icarus. It shows Icarus falling into the sea. And he uses this strange, notice how all the limbs come from the head? John's uses that, the image of Icarus here, imagery from the seasons. But in the background, is what looks like a ground plan. And you can show the next one. This is actually the floor plan of his grandfather's house where he grew up. The house had been destroyed by the time Johns wanted to use this image. So he recreated the house from memory. You know, he went room by room. And I think for all of us, you know, places we grew up are, you know, hold powerful memories, and that's really what he's trying to get at. And again, you see the Icarus figure, the imagery from the seasons, as well as other images compiled in this painting. And then here again, some of the same imagery, including this galaxy representing space and time, and this photograph that he uses again and again in his work at a certain point of his father's family. This is his grandfather who he lived with. This is Evelina, his grandmother, who was the artist who had died young. This is Jasper's father sitting on his father's knee, and then his two aunts and uncle on that side of the family. So he really, I mean, this is extremely autobiographical, but I think even if you don't know the people in the photograph, we all have these kind of photographs. Right, I mean, just change the characters. These are the family, the roots. And you know, so he shows that kind of thing, and now we get to Sharon. I think he bought this property in 1995. I know by 96 he was working here. And here we see a photograph of him looking out from the back patio of his studio. And I think you would ask me, why did he move to Sharon?
Yes. Right?
I think he was looking, he loves the country. He loves gardening. And I think he wanted a place, you know, outside of New York, but that was accessible to New York, but that, you know, had beautiful countryside and would allow him to pursue his interest in gardening, also to create an ideal kind of studio space. And in fact, he has that now, and here we see him working in his painting studio in Sharon. And this is a photograph, a relatively recent photograph of him in his painting studio. So he has a studio where on one side he does his paintings and drawings, and then on the other side he does his prints. And it's been pointed out recently that, and because there have been recent exhibitions that show paintings, drawings, and prints, that, you know, for him this is a great asset, because he can be working on a painting and a drawing, say, then go into his print studio and work on a related print, and the whole body of work comes together. Now, this is a kind of luxury it would be very hard to have in New York. And certainly earlier in his life, if he wanted to do prints, he had to go out to West Islip, Long Island, or Los Angeles, California. Now he has this incredibly beautiful studio where he can do any size work he wants and work in any medium that he wants. So I did want to mention that, and some of you I'm sure know that he has two important shows on now, one at the Katona Museum, a show of his work with John Lund, who's his primary printmaker. And this is a print that they did together that's in the exhibition. And then, of course, the final slide I'm showing, the Regrets exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art, where there's an array of two paintings, I think it is, several drawings and several prints and proofs for prints. So, you know, there's really a wonderful opportunity now to see his work in New York area museums. So, that's...
Well, I think we're all going to go look at it. Thank you, Roberta.